The piano music you just heard and the singing up here is your signal to settle into your seats and prepare for the start of our worship service. Before we begin, I call your attention to the Sunday handout. There are a few announcements, and there's a special announcement coming, but let me just kind of go over these first. Tuesday, 7:30, we got Lou Sneed is going to host a special appearance at Larkin Al Bookstore and a discussion about his book, Confessions of a Recovering Racist, What White People Must Do to Overcome Racism in America. Don't miss that. That sounds like a great program. And then next Sunday is the Flower Communion, celebrating 100 years of this special ritual, so be sure to remember to bring a flower. I will not remember that 90% chance, but I will grab one from somewhere at the last minute. And they have extra flowers, so. Dialogue with Reverend Dr. Sophia Benincourt. This is the candidate for UUA president. That's coming up on May 11th at 11 a.m. This is a, see more information in the messenger, it says. And then we have a movie night, which I'm a part of scheduling, and we scheduled this a long time, but it's actually at the same time as Lou's talk. So if you're not up for the talk, you can come see this movie, Gentleman's Agreement. It's about racism in America. It's an interesting expose of that. That's at the library at 6:30 on May 2nd. We have a pledge drive going on. We're going to have Ron come up and talk about that in a bit. We have a Zoom events from the UU Ministry of Earth. Your local social justice team hopes you can attend this one of our Zoom events presented by the UU Ministry for Earth, and then share your experience or bring back ideas to us to explore. The next event is Friday, May 5th at 6 p.m. And you can also check the messenger again for more information. All right, and then we have a special announcement, and it's going to be fun.
Thank you, John. Hi, my name's Karina Whitaker Lewis. My pronouns are she, her, and I serve as your director of religious education. And I'm at the Capitol a little bit right now. I live in Austin, and so it's a little bit easier for me to get there. And our Texas UU Justice Ministry has a special request through our partners with Texas Impact, the interfaith organization we work with. This is a very important bill, which unfortunately is so horrible, that is going to refuse gender-affirming care for people in Texas. And we want to, where we have been asked to sing This Little Light of Mine, and send that recording in with many other congregations who are going to share that with our legislators, because we want to remain hopeful about what the state of Texas can do and care for everyone in this state. So we're just gonna quickly sing it right now. It's not part of our service, so I appreciate your flexibility. We're just gonna sing this song. It's number 118 in the gray hymnal. It's not very long, so we'll just quickly do it. Jackie was very kind, and our folks who are delivering the service today were very kind to let me just kind of interrupt and have us sing this real quick. So I appreciate you singing This Little Light of Mine, because we want our Capitol to know that we have a light that shines. All right. Wonderful, and thank you. And please check the messenger for more details. And if you would like to join me at the Capitol this week, please let me know. We'd love to see you down there.
Let us now begin.
Welcome. Good morning. Welcome to St. Gabriel Unitarian Universalist Association. Whether you're here in the sanctuary or watching at home, we're glad you're here. My name is Frank Dunaway, and my pronouns are he and him. I'm a member of the Second Saturday Connections Group led by Carolyn Sassano, which got stuck for holding the bag for this service. It's a task, all joking aside, that we're happy to challenge ourselves with. Today's theme is resistance. San Gabriel is a member congregation of the Unitarian Universalist Association. There are over 1,000 UU congregations in the United States. All of us together are working for a just, peaceful, and sustainable world. Sustaining each other here in community is the first step down the long road of that important work. If you would like to know more about us and learn about upcoming events, please go to our website and sign up for our newsletter. We especially welcome new visitors. And when it is time for the offertory, you need not worry about contributing. If it's your first time with us, your presence is your gift. Please know that whoever you are, wherever you're from, whomever you love, wherever you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. It is now time to light the chalice. To Unitarian Universalists today, the flaming chalice is a symbol of hope, of the sacred quest for truth, the warmth of community, the light of reason, and more. We light a flaming chalice in worship to create a reverent space for reflection, prayer, meditation, and singing. The chalice is a symbol of resistance. When we light the chalice, we dispel the darkness of fear, hate, ignorance, and disinformation. Time for Bob.
Hi, I'm Bob. He, him.
Let's greet this day in song. Opening hymn number 210, Wade in the Water, in the gray hymnal. Please arise in body or in spirit. Just to note, there's an extra verse that does not appear in the hymnal, but it will be projected.
My feet are wet, are yours? Our affirmation is an expression of our covenant with one another. Please read after me. The words will be projected. The doctrine of this church is love.
We are here to love.
The quest of truth is its sacrament. Service is its prayer.
We are here to care for others.
To dwell together in peace.
We are here to live in peace.
To seek knowledge in freedom.
We are here to honor our differences.
To serve humanity in fellowship.
We are all connected in spirit.
To the end that all souls shall grow in harmony with the divine. Thus do we covenant with one another.
This we promise to do together.
Now it's time for the Wonder Box. I wonder what Karina has for us today.
Good morning, and I've got a Wonder Box with me. We honor curiosity at San Gabriel, so what might be in the Wonder Box today? What does that sound like? Anybody have any guesses? I would love to hear your guesses. Another box? A book maybe? Yeah? Sounding heavy. I can tell you it's heavy. All right, should we open it up and see what's in here? Oh. A can. It's a can of chickpeas, garbanzo beans. What does that make you think of?
Hummus.
Right off the bat, yeah. Good things to eat. We can find, we're going to have a story, and let's be thinking about what the story might tell us about a can of beans. We'll see. Let's listen.
The Invisible, written and illustrated by Tom Percival, published by Simon & Schuster. Isabel pulled on her favorite sweater. Ice curled across the inside of the window and crept up the corner of her bedpost. It was very beautiful, and Isabel always noticed beautiful things. But there was no escaping the fact that it was also cold, very cold. You see, Isabel's family couldn't afford to have the heating on. Isabel's family couldn't afford a lot of things, things that some people take for granted. But Isabel tried not to worry about the things she didn't have. After all, she and her family had everything that they needed. They had each other. But one day, there just wasn't enough money to pay the rent and all the bills. Isabel and her family had to leave their home, the house which held all their happy memories, and move to the far side of the city. For the first time ever, Isabel couldn't find anything beautiful to cheer herself up. This part of the city looked exactly how she felt, cold, sad, and lonely. A family drove past in a shiny car, but they looked straight through Isabel, as though she wasn't even there. None of the other smartly dressed people seemed to see her either. Isabel looked down and realized that she could barely see her own hands or her feet. She was fading away. Before long, Isabel was completely invisible. She drifted silently down the streets, as pale and thin as the wind. And nobody saw her at all. But now that Isabel was invisible, she noticed something she hadn't seen before. Other invisible people, lots of them. There was an old lady planting flowers in empty paint pots. There was the man who slept on a bench feeding the birds in the park. And there was the boy who had been forced to leave his home in another country helping to mend someone's bike. But they all seemed so alone. Isabel decided to help. She planted flowers in the paint pots. She looked after stray animals, and she helped to fix things up. Then, day by day and week by week, other people joined in too. And the more people came together, the more they could all be seen. Soon, Isabel wasn't just visible. She was vibrant, and so was her new home. And that was how Isabel made something very special, one of the hardest things that anyone can ever make. Isabel had made a difference. The end.
Applause for the story. That's so great. I have met many people at our little free pantry, folks from the neighborhood, members of the larger community around us. And some of them have been taking the food they need, and others have brought food. Sometimes that has been, this, like Isabel in the story, the same person, someone who took food from the pantry while they were in need, and then when they were able to, brought some food back in order to help others. But I would hope that we would not have to experience hardship ourselves in order to feel moved to help others. Those in difficulty, like Isabel, should not have to rely on their own bootstraps to make a bad situation better. They need allies, kind, caring people who see them, who bring the food and are also willing to work alongside them. And with that kind of broader collaboration, together we can create the systemic change needed to keep all of us out of difficult situations in the first place. Our faith calls us to make sure no one is invisible. All right, I've got plenty of fun things to do at the back if people would like to join me there, or if you want to have things to do with your hands in your seat, you can do that as well. All right.
now our treasurer, Ron, I'm going to nickname right now Super Ron, will give us an update on the pledge drive.
I come with the crew.
And you get to be at the microphone.
Hi, are you going to introduce me or anything?
I just stopped. You get to introduce yourself.
I'm nervous. I'm Allie Nagel, and Ron asked me to talk about why we come here and why we've been coming here. And we have been coming here for a couple months, more frequently recently, because over the fall the kids were sick a lot and we didn't make it. But we have really enjoyed our time here so far. I really think it's a special place, especially in a state like Texas that tends to skew pretty conservative in a lot of beliefs. It's nice to find a community of like-minded people. And I like having that community and that space to raise my children and expose them to. And I like finding a place where we can all get together and celebrate, you know, community and love and respect. And Ellie likes doing crafts in the back. That's her favorite part. And yeah, we're really grateful to be here. And I don't know. Do you have anything else, Kyle? Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. I am Super Ron. This year, the theme of our pledge drive is San Gabriel's Year to Grow. Today, we have completed week two of the San Gabriel pledge drive for 2023-24. Half of the planned campaign is behind us, and you want to know how we're doing. Here are the numbers. The first number is 32. Cards from 32 pledging units have been received. A pledging unit can be an individual, a couple, or a family. Thank you for contributing, for sending in your pledge card. The second number is 22. $22,000 is the value of new pledges and increases from the amount someone pledged last year. The number of new pledges certainly indicates that this year is a year for San Gabriel to grow. And the strengthening financial support of members and friends is heartfelt. Thank you so much. And the last number, 118. $118,000 is the total of pledges received to date during the first half of our pledge campaign. This is 70% of our $170,000 goal during the first half of the campaign. We are ahead of the curve. Thank you for your generous support of San Gabriel. Building on the Wonder Box story, we can afford to pay the rent, so we're good. If you need a pledge card, another pledge card, you lost a pledge card, they are available on the membership table at the back of the sanctuary. And during the next 2 weeks, as we finish the pledge drive, I will contact members and friends who have not submitted a pledge card just to make sure that they've received the information, a pledge card, and answer any questions they may have. So again, thank you, thank you, thank you again.
I think Super Ron is going to stick. By the way, I didn't introduce myself. I'm John, he, him. I always forget to do that. But I want to, we need to take up the offering now in line with the pledge drive. We take an offering each week to sustain this space that we call home and to support the work of our fellowship. The offertory music is For What It's Worth, written by Stephen Stills. Also, it's going to be sung by Bob and played by Jackie. And we, the offering will now be gratefully received. We thank you.
Something's happening here. What it is ain't exactly clear. There's a man with a gun over there, telling me I've got to beware. Think it's time we stop, children. What's that sound? Everybody look what's going down. There's battle lines being drawn, and nobody's right if everybody's wrong. Young people speaking their minds are getting so much resistance from behind. I think it's stop, children, what's that sound? Everybody look what's going down. What a field day for the heat. 1,000 people in the street are singing songs as they're carrying signs. Mostly say hooray for our side. It's time we stop. Hey, what's that sound? Everybody look what's going down. Paranoia strikes deep into your life, it will creep. Starts when you're always afraid to step out of line, the man comes and take it away. We better stop. Hey, what's that sound? Everybody look what's going down. Join me, please. Stop, hey, what's that sound? Everybody look what's going down. Stop, hey, what's that sound? Everybody look what's going down. Stop, hey, what's that sound? Everybody look what's going down.
I'm Carolyn Sassano. I'm going to go off script because as a Unitarian, sometimes we don't follow the rules. Sometimes it's hard to know how we can make a difference in these difficult times. So I saw an ID company online that makes road IDs for people who are athletes, or you get them for your pets that have emergency information on them. And I thought, what would a Unitarian put on their road ID? So I put it on mine, and I'm wearing it today. And it reminds me of all of the compassionate people in this church. And this is what it says. I am only one, but I still am one. I cannot do everything, but still I can do something. And because I cannot do everything, I will not refuse to do something that I can do. Everett Hale, American author. And on that note, joys and concerns. And as we prepare to share joys and concerns, please settle in your seats. Let us give each other the gift of attention, deep breaths, and we invite stillness in this moment. Check. Is that you?
Rule breaker.
It's time to take my pills.
Okay, so we invite anyone who has a joy or concern and wants to share it with the congregation to do so now. Beth will pass the microphone. Thank you, Vanna. And I will drop a stone in the water for each. If you feel like it, please stand and state your name as you share with us. Joys and concerns.
Good morning, everybody. I'm Linda Hansen, and I have a wonderful joy to share today. I was a member of this congregation for a number of years. I had a health issue a year and a half ago, and my son came down, and he and my daughter-in-law took me up to Michigan for a year to recuperate. At the end of that time, I made a decision to come back here. I missed everybody. I missed this congregation and this fellowship very much. My son did not agree with me in this decision to come back. He did not support me in this decision to come back. But he has been down here visiting his dad, who had surgery this week. He finally showed up at my door this morning at 8 o'clock. He said, "Mom, we're back." It brought tears to my eyes. We had not communicated in 5 months. So the joy that I'm feeling today is exquisite. Thank you.
Any others?
My name is Ruth Fuller. We're relatively new. He joined, I didn't, whatever. our son, we moved here because our son lives here, who's 32, works for a large marketing and advertising firm in Austin. And he won an award given out by an ad association in the Austin area. It's called 32 Under 32. So he won an award as one of the 32 Under 32, and we're going down for the awards ceremony in Austin on Thursday.
Hi, my name is Linda Mueller, and I can't stop crying right now because I'm so filled with joy at seeing all these people here. I remember the first time I came to this church in 2015, I just happened to notice a sign and thought, I'm going to check this place out, and here I am. And I remember when you couldn't find a seat, when there were 30 children playing and going to the little house. And this morning, I look around and see all these people, and I can't stop crying with joy that this fellowship is, we're just kicking and screaming and fighting to stay alive, and by darn, we're doing it. And Allie, you said it exactly right when you said you needed a place where like-minded people who make sense gather. I'm also the secretary of our board, and talking about kicking and screaming, last year when the nominating committee, which I was on, we worked so hard to find people to keep this place going, and no one wanted to do it. And finally, Molly isn't here, our president, I wish she were. She agreed to be secretary finally. And I thought, okay, now we need a president. Nobody wanted to be president, but one day I was sitting thinking, okay, Molly would be a great president. And I said, all right, I'll be secretary if you take the presidency. And she said, yes. And I wish you were still here to see. This is, those of you who are new or just walking in maybe the first time, you just have no idea how exciting it is to those of us who held on to this place during COVID online on Zoom, and worried so that we were just going to disappear. So when I see all your faces, I just want to thank you. And also, if someone asks you to do a job, take it. I never thought I'd say I would be on the board of any church, much less a secretary, and I only have two more meetings to go. But nonetheless, it was a highlight of my life, and I feel proud that as an octogenarian, I'm still here fighting for what's right in this world. And when I see young people like you, and Linda, you're back, right? Anyway, that's all.
I'm Mimi, my name is Mimi Ray, and a month or so ago, I shared with you the joy that it's been almost 6 months, my granddaughter, Emma, accepted the proposal to wed Shri, and I can't even pronounce his last name, and they're gonna be married the next February. And he is an Indian, and a wonderful, wonderful person. And his family, his mother and father are in Houston, but the rest of the family, of course, is in India. So Emma and Shri just got back from a 3-week journey to India and other places, where Emma met with Shri's mother's family, huge number of people, and Shri's father's family, another huge number of people in two different parts of India. And they had a wonderful time. And I think that everybody on both sides of the union were a little concerned. It's cultural differences. But I figure that anybody who can travel together for 3 weeks and still feel good, it's bound to be a good sign.
Any others?
I'll be brief. I'm Kyle Nagel, and I'll just say that it's really nice to have my mother-in-law, Kelly, here with us today.
Hey, I'm Lucy. This is my first time here. I'm here with my grandma and my boyfriend. And I've come a few times. We were in Florida, and we'd go in Florida and stuff. But it's just super exciting to be here, and I haven't been in a while to church in general. But it's really nice to be here. You guys are very fun, I guess. I don't know. It's nice. You guys are all so kind and excited to be here, and it makes me excited to be here and want to come back. So I'm very grateful for this day and happy to be here. You guys are cool.
Thank you for bringing your joys and sorrows forward. Pause. Let's take a deep cleansing breath and exhale. For the joys shared, we join together in celebration. For the sorrows and concerns, we feel empathy and compassion. For all that remains unspoken, may the caring of the community offer a space of deep kindness and care. Bob.
All right, how about we sing another song together? We're gonna do Please Rise in Body or Spirit, hymn number 1021, Lean on Me by Bill Withers. We are gonna be singing Bill Withers' original lyrics, which might be slightly different than what's in the hymnal. But they will be projected.
Sometimes in our lives, we all have pain, we all have sorrow.
somebody to lean on. Just call on me, brother, when you need a hand. We all need somebody to lean on. I just might have a problem that you understand. We all need somebody to lean on. If there is a load you have to bear that you can't carry, I'm right up the road and I'll share your load. If you just
good morning. My name is Beth Gehrman, and my pronouns are she and her. And I'll be reading a sermon this morning, and it's written by Reverend Karen Anderson. When I was a young woman, I had a few men in my life I was smitten by. And I mean smitten as in I had a little piece and a place in my heart that made up the qualities of my ideal man. They were in this order: my daddy, Mick Jagger, my cousin Trond, and Henry David Thoreau. What a group. All of them good guys. Well, I really don't know about Jagger, but men more or less that I admired for some character strength they all had. Concerning Henry David Thoreau, it was certainly not because of the way he looked. In fact, his contemporary, Nathaniel Hawthorne, described him as this: he is ugly as sin, long-nosed, queer-mouthed, with uncouth and somewhat rustic manners. But his ugliness is of an honest and agreeable fashion and becomes him much better than beauty. So yes, I was smitten with a man who wouldn't have made any girls turn head over being debonair or charming or handsome on the other side of the room. No, that's not why I liked him. I liked him because he was a person who lived his life with great intention. Thoreau was a New England writer in the 1800s. He was a recluse of sorts, an amateur botanist who became famous in later years through the Transcendentalist movement, but also for living in a little shack on Walden Pond that was about 10 feet by 10 feet outside of Concord, Massachusetts, where he wrote and was present to his life and the natural world. What people don't know, by the way, is that he quite often in a week would trudge through the woods to his mother's house for dinner. Now, there are some great stories to tell about Thoreau, but this one has always captured my imagination. Seems Henry needed to pick up his shoe at the cobbler's shop, so he walked to Concord, Massachusetts, and on his way, he ran into Sam Staples. Now, Sam Staples is the constable of the town, and Sam is responsible for collecting the poll tax, which was assessed on all male adults from the age of 22 to 70. Thoreau, then 29, had not paid the tax for years, and owing to certain personal convictions, wasn't about to either. Staples says to Thoreau, "Henry, if you don't pay, I'll surely have to lock you up." To which Thoreau replied, "Well, now is as good a time as any." So Thoreau was taken to the county jail, and there he stays overnight in this little cell with the barred windows. He was released in the morning after his Aunt Maria heard what had happened and dropped off money on her nephew's behalf. Most people would have been grateful. Thoreau was not. A year or so before his overnight incarceration, Henry had spoken with candor at the town's lyceum about his opinions of the poll tax. This is what he said: "Refusing to pay taxes in a country that tolerates slavery and has recently launched an unjust war on Mexico is not a crime, but a moral obligation to rebel, resist, and revolutionize. Soon after all this hoopla, he wrote that wonderful essay on the duty of civil disobedience, which, as one author put it, he has always been kind of a stirring ode to a nonconformist who puts conscience above the letter of the law and the will of the minority. Thoreau is kind of an iconoclastic Unitarian folk hero, or an intellectual hero, you might say, a man who lived with great intention when it came to his principles. This man, ugly as sin, has always been someone to emulate when it comes to character, as a building block to a good moral conduct. That is, until I read this book by Ale Press called Beautiful Souls. Press skillfully tells the story of people who said no, broke the ranks, and heeded the voice of conscience in dark times. As I am reading this book, I am thinking it is going to point to examples of intentional living that could help guide us all in the direction of what makes a society better. And that, of course, was predicated on the belief that if we bring our best selves forward in service to the common good, we can make the larger good better. Except what I was expecting to find didn't hold true. Press tells many stories of principled, ordinary people who on first blush seem to have done amazing things just because of exemplar character. I want to start with this guy named Paul Gerniger. Gerniger was the commander of the state police in St. Gallen, a northwestern town in Switzerland that butts up against Austria. Basically, he was the head hoo-ha of border police in his area. Now, this was 1938. The Swiss government had closed its borders and had instructed all the border guards not to let anybody in without proper documentation. Nobody. No ifs or buts or maybe. But we all know from 10th grade history that there were many Jews trying to get the hell out of Dodge. In November of 1938, the Nazis stormed Vienna in an organized assault known as Kristallnacht, which turned Austria's state capital into a city of terror and violence. Hundreds of Jews were vandalized and their shops broken apart. Dozens of temples were burned down and countless injuries and fatalities were recorded. The assault left little doubt that there was unification of Austria and Germany. What all of this would mean for Jews. That said, with the borders closed and strict orders to enforce it, there were indeed many people trying to find safe passage out of the country. Many of them couldn't do it, but something happened at Gerniger's post because many Jews were making it to Switzerland finding refuge. Now, Gerniger was the commander of his unit. He was considered a conservative person. He was not a rule breaker. He sang in his church choir and was a proud patriot and civil servant. So why did he, time and time again, when Jews sought refuge, help them make it past the border into Switzerland at his post? I began to wonder if maybe just Paul had exceptional character, but what I learned is people's moral conduct often has nothing to do with their character. In fact, in other books I've read on rescuers, many of the character traits of a lot of these heroes of mercy, you might call them, we wouldn't want to uplift. Sometimes they were cheats and thieves, hijackers and blackmailers. So if it wasn't character, what was it? The answer actually lies back in Gerniger's story. He knew the rules. Nobody was really allowed to pass. Almost all of the other border captains delegated the responsibility to somebody else. They knew the decree and passed the rule on to a subordinate, and then they went about their business. Paul did not. Each person who was seeking asylum stood in front of him, pleading for his help. In fact, because he let hundreds of people actually cross the border, Gerniger was fired and disgraced by his community up until the end of his life. He spent decades after the war trying to regain his good standing amongst his people. At one point, he actually wrote to the Swiss government defending his actions by saying this: "Whoever had the opportunity to repeatedly witness the heartbreaking kinds of scenes of the concerns of the people, the screaming and crying of mothers and children, the threats and suicide and attempts to do it, I ultimately couldn't do it anymore." You see, it turns out that the one thing all the rescuers have in common, who have exemplified exceptional moral conduct, who did what was right, was not a common character trait, but instead a proximity to suffering firsthand. The only common factor, L. Press writes, what ultimately determines moral conduct are not character traits, personal beliefs, or political attitudes, but situational factors. The social psychologist Stanley Milgram, who worked at Yale in the 1960s, did a whole bunch of work around this, and he concluded that a person's proximity to harm or suffering always directly correlated on how responsible they felt to alleviate the suffering before them. I went back to Thoreau. "I have forever and a day lifted up his actions as the exemplar of character, of intentional principled living that guided one's moral conduct. But I have missed something, and it is this. There is a difference, a distinction between being a good person and being a good citizen, or I believe being a good religious person. So here's the thing. I can't believe that I'm saying this, but we need to do more than Thoreau. Yes, he was a man who held strong character traits of honor, justice, and judgment, but his view was limited, mainly because it ends with the personal with me. It ends with, as long as my hands are not tainted by wrongdoing, then I'm okay, I'm good. But I don't see how we can end there. Our own Unitarian Universalist principles, in particular the last one, respect for the interdependent web of which we are a part, strikes me as being impossible to uphold if we are all Thoreau. Our own theology of connection, with an emphasis on reminding each other that we are all inextricably not just bound to each other as human beings, but that the well-being of one another is indeed related to our own well-being. This couldn't be possible with Thoreau's attitude. As a Unitarian Universalist minister, I am fond of saying we are here together to serve needs greater than our own. But perhaps a better way of saying that is to see each other's needs as our own. That goes beyond Thoreau's "my hands are clean and I'm done." It also demands more than good character and intentional, purposeful living. It means that we must continually be in close proximity to those who are the victims of the evil we want to wash our hands of. It means we engage. We don't stop here. Instead, we promise to one another, this little band of us in this room, we will stay close to the suffering of the human condition so we are not only good people with good character, people who live with intention, but we are good religious people, good world citizens, good sisters and brothers to the human family. So while it is important to work on being a good person by developing one's character, it is equally important to think, to live in proximity. I don't think it's easy. 15 years ago, I brought a group of teenagers from a church I was serving at the time with me in Mexico to Matamoros with the New York State Labor Religion Coalition. We had gone to two border towns to see ostensibly what the effects of NAFTA were on third world countries in person. We met with workers in their home that were often built with pallets and scrap metal and cardboard. They had no locks, no running water, no latrine, no electricity, dirt floors. Homes that when we visited them, they raked the front yard, which was just dirt in their 12-foot front lawn, and they got the debris out. They commented on what an honor they felt by being able to talk to their northern brothers and sisters. At one home, I remember 3 5-gallon buckets turned upside down where a board was put on top so we'd have a place to sit. And they all stood and talked to us. We were on that board, and they had put white hand towels with poinsettia patterns. I can still see it in my head. The towels were the only immaculate piece of cloth for miles, and which they insisted we sit on. For 6 days, we listened to stories. So at one point on the trip, they said, we are going to take you to a grocery store where the equivalent of what two adults could afford on $6 a day. You could get rice, beans, and oil, but there was not enough money to buy cornmeal for tortillas. There was nothing left over for clean water or toilet paper. Most parents sent their kids to work at sixth grade because in sixth grade, you had to start paying for education. So when you can't buy toilet paper, what wins out? Certainly not an education. So the point I'm trying to make is this. I have had the proximity in my life numerous times. This is possibly the most striking example, but doesn't have to be a foreign visit to witness and experience suffering. But this experience was years ago now. And in that time, there have been new labor laws and immigration rights for farm workers that I've wanted to stay on top of. But I have found the farther my proximity gets in time, the farther I get from relational closeness to those suffering from the injustice. I start forgetting. Not entirely, but I start forgetting what that firsthand experience feels like in my gut. If you were there, you would have felt like I did, that it's sheer luck that the squalor and abject poverty and diminishing future wasn't the cards that were dealt to me. That's it. It's all freaking luck. And it is in proximity that you get gut kicks and that you can see the person in front of you as their needs being your needs. That was years ago now, and I am in need of, well, that kind of gut-moving, personal, relational, close-up experience more often. I would submit we probably all could use a little more of this, but here's the thing. Committed action in church or personally usually looks mostly like Thoreau. Thoreau did all this right thinking and thoughtful writing and provided people with good arguments, said the right things, held the right positions. But besides not paying his taxes, he didn't really do anything. Because real change, both in the external world and internally, perhaps where it's most important, internally needs more than that formula. Yes, it takes thinking carefully about an issue, but it's more. It's actually taking getting close, allowing the pain of others to alter you, to be in relationship with people, to activate your empathy, and then committed action arises. So my friends, my work with you in the next 1.5 years is simple. It's helping you to ask the right questions so you can become the change you want to see in the world collectively. There are many ways about going and doing this, but I know for certain I'm going to rely on the lessons I learned about proximity. That's right. Proximity positioning is more important than right thinking. Cultivating close relationships is more important than cultivating careful thought. That the formula we have always thought works, get informed, get passionate, get going, is flawed. It has unintentional consequences to it because you only get halfway there. It's time we resisted this way of thinking and change our perspective and approach. Get informed, get close, and get going is akin to walking up to Paul Grüniger's grave and telling him, you did good. Though he wasn't recognized at the time for his good deeds, nor decades after, there is a little band of feisty Unitarian Universalists who know he's onto something. When you look suffering in the eye, it is Grüniger's life. We want to hold on to our moral example of the good religious life. And it is this little band of fierce UUs that today lay our hearts in metaphorical flowers in front of his grave and say thank you for that invaluable lesson. Get informed, my friends, but before you get going, get close. May proximity save us all. May it be so. Amen.
It is now time to extinguish our chalice. In doing so, let our lives be a prayer that waters dry souls, that mends broken hearts, that refuses to be terrorized, that seeks this world's beauty and carries us through life's storms. Before we end with a song from Bob and Jackie, we would like to thank Jackie for her wonderful piano accompaniment. Bob for his singing. The tech team and hospitality for all their great work. The welcome team and announcement helpers. Lastly, we would like to thank our connections group leader, Carolyn, for her great leadership. Please feel free to stay for coffee and conversation and goodies after the song, but stay in your seats until it's over.
If you so wish. Song by Garth Brooks and Stephanie Davis.
This ain't coming from no prophet, just an ordinary man. When I close my eyes, I see the way the world shall be when we all walk hand in hand. When the last child cries for a crust of bread, when the last man dies for just words he said, when the shelter over the poorest head, we shall be free. When the last thing we notice is the color of skin, and the first thing we look for is the beauty within. When the skies and oceans are clear again, we shall be free. We shall be free. We shall be free. Stand straight, stand proud, 'cause we shall be free. When we're free to love anyone we choose, when this world's big enough for all different views, when we can worship from our own kind of pew, then we shall be free. We shall be free. We shall be free. Have a little faith, hold out, 'cause we shall be free. And when money talks for the very last time, and nobody walks a step behind, when there's only one race, and that is mankind, we shall be free. Join in. We shall be free. We shall be free. Stand straight, walk proud, 'cause we shall be free. 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 Have a little faith. Walk proud. 'Cause we shall be free. Coffee and goodies in the kitchen. Thank you, everybody, so much.